Today's reading scripture is 1 John 1, 1 to 2. What was from the beginning, we have heard, we have seen with our eyes, we have looked at and touched with our hands concerning the word of life. The life was manifested. We have seen and testify and proclaim to you the eternal life, which was with the Father and was manifested to us. After Golden Light Choir's praise, we will watch the senior pastor's video sermon, the lecture on the 1 John. Brothers and sisters in Christ, church members, foreign churches, local sanctuaries, and all the church members who are attending this service online in the world, GCN viewers, beginning with this service, I'll be delivering lectures based on the 1 John. Among the 12 disciples, the Apostle John, the writer of 1 John, was a disciple who was loved by Jesus very much. Now the Apostle Paul's face is on the screen. In the Gospel of John, John many times refers to himself as the disciple whom Jesus loved. He was always with Jesus at the important places during his ministry, and he was with Jesus until Jesus died on the cross. He witnessed the resurrection and ascension of Jesus. Since then, John worked as one of the leaders of the early church along with Peter, James, and the other disciples. It is said that in his later days, he ministered seven churches in the Asia Minor, and he died at about the age of 90, around 100 AD. Originally, he had such a hot temper that he was called the Son of Thunder. But he was completely changed during his later days, and he was called the Apostle of Love. John wrote five of the books in the New Testament. There are the Gospel of John, the Book of Revelation, and the 1st and 2nd and 3rd John. As I previously explained in the lecture on the Gospel of John, it is said that he was arrested by the Roman Emperor Domitian and thrown into a pot of boiling oil, but he was unharmed even in the boiling oil, and he was later exiled to the land of Patmos. While he was on the land of Patmos, in deep communication with God, he recorded the Book of Revelation. Now, the island of Patmos is on the screen. We don't know the exact year when 1 John was written, but it is known that it was around 90 AD before Revelation was recorded. Could you play the video where we see the cave in which John prayed? The cave where he prayed, there is the place he put on his hands. There are his handprints. His head was placed there. Look at his face carefully. Look at his forehead. His forehead is very thick. He often hit the rock his head during his prayers, and it caused his forehead thick. First John repeatedly talks about God's Son, Jesus Christ, and that the believers have to depart from sins. If you understand the background of writing this book, 1 John, you will be able to understand its content even better. At the time of the early church, there were some people who were deceiving others. There was also Gnosticism, which is a heretical thought. Most people said they believed the gospel, but they spread a mistaken and false teaching among the believers. For example, they did not acknowledge that Jesus is the Son of God who came to this earth in human flesh. They also denied that Jesus died on the cross and resurrected. Also, they said that if people just acknowledge about God, then they did not have to live moral lives. They claimed the spirit and body are separate, so their spirit could be saved even though their bodies committed sins. The Apostle John was firmly refuting such radical ideas. John proclaims Jesus Christ is one with God, the Creator in a reason, and the Son of God. He says Jesus came to the earth into a human body, died on the cross, resurrected, and ascended into heaven, thereby becoming the Savior for all mankind. He also says we can receive salvation by knowledge, but we are saved when we believe in Jesus Christ and live in the light. These are general ideas that are repeatedly explained in the book of 1 John. These messages are also the foundations of the Holiness Gospel that you listen to in this church all the time. I once gave the lecture on the First John during the Sunday evening service in 1985 and 86. That time, the church members knew these messages were spiritually deep, but they couldn't really understand fully and cultivate them in their hearts. They may have thought they understood. However, they probably also felt it was difficult. But now, since your faith has grown up, you can keep these messages in your hearts and cultivate them in you as soon as you hear it. Imagine this book of 1 John is a letter sent to you personally, and meditate on it again and again. I urge you to try to feel the voice of Apostle John speaking to you personally. At the time, John was more than 80 years old. He had already spent his happy days with Jesus and overcame so many hardships in the early church. James, Andrew, Matthew, and Thomas, and finally Peter, all those disciples who had the same memories of the Lord and had been able to rely on one another, had all been martyred. Now, this old apostle is once again standing against heretical doctrines being spread, and he was proclaiming the truth of the Lord. I hope you will accept this beautiful message with the inspiration of the Holy Spirit and quickly accomplish holiness. I pray in the name of the Lord, you will only walk in the light and be recognized as the Son of God who is the light. Brothers and sisters, 1 John 1:1-4 is the introduction of the book of 1 John. He explains the motivation and purpose of John for writing this book. Verse 1 says, "What was from the beginning, what we have heard, what we have seen with our eyes, what we have looked at and touched with our hands concerning the word of life." In the book, the beginning has two meanings. First, Genesis 1:1 says, "In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth." Here, the beginning refers to the time when God created the heavens and the earth. Some say they are interesting this creation in biblical view and say that the creation took place 6,000 years ago. But the 6,000-year duration of human cultivation is not from the creation of heavens and earth to the end of the world. This 6,000-year period begins from the time when Adam was driven out from the Garden of Eden to this earth due to sin. From the time of the creation to the time when Adam committed sin, such a long time had passed. It is unimaginable for human beings. But even though it was a very, very long time, there certainly was the beginning. The beginning in the book of Genesis is the beginning of a certain point in time. Next, John 1:1 says, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, the Word was God." Here, the beginning is even before the creation. It is before eternity, and it has no beginning or end. God exists by himself, and he is an eternal being who has neither beginning nor end. We can say he began to exist from a certain point of time. But since men are beings that have limits within our limited thinking, it is difficult, if not impossible, for men to understand the concept of eternity. To help us understand earlier, God says the word beginning as if there had been truly a beginning. But the beginning in 1 John 1:1 has the same meaning with the beginning in the Gospel of John, which is a point in time before the eternity. Now, what is the word of life that was from the beginning? Conclusively speaking, it refers to Jesus Christ, the Son of God. John 1:1 says, "In the beginning was the Word was with God, the Word was God." I believe you have already heard about it in detail. Know it well. At first, it says the Word was God. The Word is God. In other words, the 66 books of the Bible is God Himself. So it seems God and the Word are the same. But it also says the Word was with God. So it seems Word and God are different beings. It's difficult to understand within human thinking, but you can understand it easily since you have now listened to the Genesis lectures. The mentioned verse is an explanation concerning God the Trinity, God the Son, who proceeded from God the Father, who is Jesus Christ, is one with God the Father, and has the same heart, mind, and will. We'll explain about the separation of the triune God in verse 2 again. As God the Father is the Word, God the Son is also the Word in essence. John 1:14 says, "And the Word became flesh, and dwelt among us, and we saw His glory, glory as of the only begotten from the Father, full of grace and truth." God, who is the Word, had the human flesh and came down to this earth, and He is Jesus. And why is Jesus Christ, the Word from the beginning, referred to as Word of life, not just word? It is to emphasize the fact that Jesus came down to this earth to give us an eternal life. 1 John 5:12 says, "He who has the Son has the life. He who does not have the Son of God does not have the life." Also, John 14:6 says, Jesus said to him, "I am the way, and the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but through me." Jesus Christ alone can give us eternal life. About how Jesus Christ alone can give us life, and how He gives us life, will be explained later. At this point, you can just keep in mind that the Word of life that is from the beginning refers to Jesus Christ. 1 John 1:1 says, "What was from the beginning, what we have heard, we have seen with our eyes, we have looked at and touched with our hands concerning the Word of God, Word of life." About this Word of life, namely about Jesus Christ, it says we have heard, seen, looked at, and touched it with our hands, namely including the Apostle John, numerous disciples were the witness of Jesus Christ. The disciples heard the gospel of the kingdom of heaven from Jesus directly. They also heard Jesus is the Son of God and the Savior of mankind. When they were by themselves with Jesus, they also heard more of the deep spiritual messages that other people could not hear. They heard about the love of God, about the kingdom of heaven, spiritual realm, and other deep secrets. Also, while walking with Jesus, they witnessed firsthand countless works of power. They also witnessed Jesus' death on the cross, his resurrection and ascension. The verse doesn't just say they just saw, but that they looked at it because they didn't just casually see it. After seeing it, they received the grace to engrave it in their hearts. They were enabled to change. Also, as it says, we touched it with our hands. They experienced the ministry of Jesus firsthand. When the Lord who died on the cross resurrected, they even touched his resurrected body. Now, how about you compared to them? Would anybody say the disciples of Jesus saw and heard firsthand, but you haven't heard or seen anything? Of course, it's not true. You also have heard, seen, and touched it. You heard the way of salvation hidden since before the time began. You heard in so much detail about the eternal God and the spiritual realm. You also heard about the second coming of the Lord, the final judgment, and heaven and hell. You have heard to such great detail that you should even be able to picture it. Furthermore, you always experience the works of the Holy Spirit that proves the messages are true. The words written in the Bible are confirmed in the lives of those who obey those words. To the extent that you practice the word and your soul prospers, all the promised blessings are given to you. You also experience numerous signs and wonders that Jesus performed about 2,000 years ago, so you can also say that you met the Lord. You've seen the miraculous signs and wonders that took place in the Bible so many times, haven't you? You can see God, who is Spirit, with your physical eyes, but through the Bible and the works of the Holy Spirit, you can understand God's heart, experience Him as if you had touched Him. And when you obey the Word, which tells of God's heart, thoughts, and will, you experience as if you touched Him. The following verse, 1 John 1, 2, says, "And the life was manifested, and we have seen and testify and proclaim to you eternal life, which was with the Father and was manifested to us." The eternal life that the disciples saw, namely Jesus Christ, was with God the Father, but came down to this earth in human flesh. Now, at this point, let me briefly explain about God the Trinity. Originally, God existed alone, and at that time, He did not have a certain form. He existed as light that filled the whole universe, and the chiming voice from within. That light is very colorful like auroras, and it filled whole space like a stream of water. Along with that light, the beautiful voice also filled the whole universe. John refers to this voice as the Word, that is, from the beginning. This light that embedded the voice and filled the whole universe cohered at a vertex in the spiritual realm. And from this cohered light, two more lights proceeded forth. Now there's on the screen. The same kind of light proceeded from the original light, and now there were three lights. It's not that one light was divided into three, but two additional lights of the same kind were made from the original light. This is the process of God who existed alone as the Word, made Himself into the Trinity. The original light is God the Father. The two lights that proceeded from the original light was God the Son and God the Holy Spirit. These three lights took on similar form as that of human beings. Genesis 1:26 says, "Let us make man in our image, according to our likeness."
The form
of man was made in the image of God. Of course, God does not always exist in the same form as human beings. It is necessary he can exist in any kind of form he wants. This God, the Son named Jesus Christ, who came out of the Father, stayed with the Father and the Holy Spirit for a long time. As it is recorded in the book of Genesis, it was this triune God who together created the world. And about 4,000 years after Adam was driven out to this earth due to his sin, God did something very amazing. God the Son was conceived by the Holy Spirit in the body of Virgin Mary, and he was born into this world, having the body of a human being, his creatures. Namely, as written in John 1:14, the Word became flesh and dwelt among men. I already said the reason why he appeared among us is to give us life. It's not the physical life that fades away soon, but it was to give us an eternal life. In fact, all mankind, descendants of Adam, are sinners. They have the original sin inherited from Adam, and they also commit sins themselves. Even if somebody does not commit any sin in his life, he still has the original sin, and he's a sinner. According to the rules of the spiritual realm, the wages of sin is death. This death refers to spiritual death, which is the eternal punishment in hell. Due to sins, men could not meet the Holy Spirit. They were destined to fall into hell after their lives on earth were over. But Jesus, who came down to this earth, carried the cross, and while he was innocent, he died on it and redeemed us from our sins. Because sin is Jesus took the death instead of us, we can now avoid death. When we become united with Jesus Christ by faith, we can be forgiven for our sins. To redeem us from our sins, the Lord took the cross and shed his precious blood. He wore the crown of thorns on his head, shed blood, he was whipped and shed blood, he was nailed on his hands and feet and shed blood to redeem all our transgressions and sins. By wearing a crown of thorns on his head and shedding his blood, he redeemed us from all the sins committed in our thoughts. And by being nailed on his hands and feet, he redeemed us from all the sins committed with our hands and feet. And he was pierced in his side and shed water and blood. The Lord broke the authority of death and resurrected, so we can also gain eternal life by believing him. The reason why God, who existed alone, separated himself into the Trinity was to perform this task. When the time came, God separated himself into the Trinity, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. So if we receive God the Son as our Savior, we receive the Holy Spirit as a gift and become children of God, and our names are written in the Book of Life. And the Holy Spirit helps us reach eternal life and helps our souls prosper as God's sons and our daughters. When the time came and our Lord ascended, the Holy Spirit came, and he was with us and helps us recover the lost image of God by letting our seeds of life grow to prosper our souls. He leads us to heaven. When God first planned human cultivation, He knew Adam would commit sin. He knew Adam and his descendants would fall into death due to their sins, and they would not be redeemed or saved by their own strength. How could this be possible? So this is the reason why God separated Himself into God the Son to take the duty of redeeming mankind. The reason why God the Holy Spirit was separated was to bear the complete fruit of this way of salvation of the cross that was fulfilled by God the Son. As explained, it says that John is proclaiming about Jesus Christ was with God and who appeared to us and gave us life for us. John is saying he himself is a personal witness to the fact that Jesus is one with God in a reason, and even though some might deny Jesus, He is the source of our eternal life. I will continue this message next week. Let me conclude this message. Brothers and sisters in Christ, those of you who have listened to the Genesis lectures have already heard these contents you heard today. Now, how deeply do you understand these messages in your heart? The God of glory who existed throughout the universe separated Himself into the Trinity for the purpose of human cultivation. Through accepting the sufferings and death on the cross, human cultivation is being fulfilled by God the Son. The purpose of cultivation is for God to gain true children who resemble Him. It is to gain children who resemble Him, who is the light, who understand His heart, and who can share true love with Him. For this reason, He, God the Son, forsook the glory of the Creator and assumed the form of a lowly creature. He took the cruel sufferings of the cross. For a long time He has been waiting and endured with tears for you to change. He is still praying for us at the right side of God's throne. How can such things take place? Can you feel deep in your heart how amazing and heart-moving these events really are? If you can, you will feel these lectures on 1 John taste as sweet as honey in your mouth. Also, you will try with all your heart, mind, and soul to become the fruit of holiness and pay back this love as much as possible. During this week, I urge you to meditate on the heart of God and live a holy life each day with a desire to repay this love of the Father. In doing so, we pray in the name of the Lord that you will quickly change into perfect children who resemble God.
합니다. 아미다 오라르슈 아이노슈 소레와 이노치아 타에르 스쿠이노